Good evening, nerd fam, and welcome back to KubeCon CloudNativeCon here in, like I said, shockingly sunny London, England. My name is Savannah Peterson, sandwiched between two of my favorite smart gentlemen on the planet, quite frankly. We've got Rob Strechay on my left, Dustin Kirkland on my right. Thank you both for being here to close out our fantastic coverage here on day two.
This has been great. I mean, I think today has just been a fantastic day, and I think, you know, nice to, you know, end it with a friendly face.
Aw, oh, thanks, Rob. Good seeing you, Savvy.
It's a nice, I know, it's only been a couple days since we were at Chainguard.
A week ago, we were in San Francisco.
It was.
Sunny as well, by the way.
I know, we were having quite, you know, maybe we, are we the sun?
I think so.
I think we might be bringing the light.
I think so.
And, you know, it might be sunny in Vegas when we're there
next week
as well.
Yeah.
We just need our own jet at this point to go from the events that we're...
If we could just bring the weather. I'm sure we've got some listeners, viewers here who have, some cloudy, rainy skies, want some sun. We'll come visit.
Yes. Yeah, come to London, which would always be my advice. You know, I was going to make a joke about how much... has happened between now and the last time I saw you with the assumption that there wasn't going to be any huge breaking news, but that's not the case.
Never a dull moment.
Never a dull moment over at Chainguard. And I'm particularly excited about this one because chips mean different things in the United States and here. Potato chips versus French fries. And then you just announced chips this morning. What does that mean?
Yeah, indeed. I guess here in London, you want chips with your fish and chips. That was not what was going through my mind in Texas when we named these chips intended to go with your salsa. The supply chain level for software artifacts, OpenSSF, runs the Salsa project, which talks about hardening build systems to ensure that the artifacts that come out of a build system are, in fact, you know, what you think they are, that they've been built well, built right, built correctly in a secure build environment. That project's been going on for a couple of years. The founders of Chainguard, Dan and Kim, were both involved in the, you know, creation and establishment of Salsa itself. One thing that, from a Chainguard perspective, we provide the hardened container images, and we've often been asked if we could compare our container images to developer images or to some other images or to images that are just in Docker Hub or upstream. And we started talking about hardening them and talking about the more scale for, you know, diamond hardness and mineral hardness. And in fact, that wasn't nearly as appropriate as complementing salsa levels. So we came up with this concept of chips. Chips stands for container hardening priorities, CHP, and then through the S in there. And we talk about it across a couple of different dimensions. So happy to tell you all about it here today.
Yeah, I think what's interesting about that is because, I mean, the OpenSSF stuff, it's been a coming together again of security and KubeCon and CloudNativeCon, where they'd kind of gone apart. Now they're back together again, all in harmony, and OpenSSF being another Linux Foundation, organization and things. Have you seen that a lot of the stuff coming out of them has really percolated into this community? Because, I mean, they do a lot with NIST and a lot with the,
absolutely,
you know, all of that. And
yeah, great organization. We get asked about salsa levels all the time, and at Chainguard we've got a product security team that's focused on increasing and ensuring that, you know, we hit salsa level 3 for our build system, building in secure, isolated environments. It's important to our customers, it's important to us. And so, yeah, we see this as a tactically focused, execution-focused complement to the salsa level. Salsa level is about the build, chips level is about the runtime. Can you run this container as absolutely securely as possible? So we grade across four separate dimensions. The first one's minimalism. Really, it's about removing anything that doesn't need to be there. There are lots of things in almost every container that's not a Chainguard container that doesn't need to be there. It could be sample code. It could be the package manager. We actually remove the package manager from the production images, which means that if an attacker got into that image or a script or malicious code script kiddie, you couldn't just add other packages into it. Right. We also remove the shell. Not having BusyBox or bin.sh or bash in a container that doesn't need it removes a huge threat surface. If the point of that container is to run user bin nginx and serve web pages, and you don't need LS and CP and DD and, you know, the BusyBox family of utilities, you can remove a whole bunch of threats out of that container. So that's one of the dimensions.
Yeah, I mean, to me that makes a lot of sense, just having been there and built, I mean, we both have worked for hyperscalers, and where you get into that, you got to really, because you are getting attacked all the time.
Right.
Are you seeing that this has even become a bigger discussion because of AI? Because, I mean, I look at AI as it's in many cases going to be the intellectual property of that company.
Sure.
Is in that model, is in that mm-hmm. service, is in that thing.
World's biggest honeypots. I mean, that's what LLMs are. It's all of your secrets. Could be company secrets. It could be national defense secrets. It could be healthcare information, privacy information. You put that all into an AI model, and it's just incredible what good could come out of that. But it's also certainly an attack, a very interesting attack surface. I call, you know, any LLM a very interesting honeypot of information.
How are you guiding your community down that pathway then of guarding that? Because I mean, most companies now just adopting LLMs at scale. Prototyping, I would say more than anything. But this wasn't necessarily a challenge they had 5 years ago.
Yeah, I mean, we start with the zero CVE approach. CVE, common vulnerabilities and exploits. These are known vulnerabilities in software that in most cases have a known fix for it. With Chainguard container images and now our virtual machines and libraries, we're eliminating those vulnerabilities. And I think that's just the starting point. If you're not starting from a position where you've eliminated the vulnerabilities, I mean, it could really be a case of liability. What sort of liabilities
exactly,
are you opening,
that's what I was
opening yourself
about.
Up
yeah.
to?
Yeah, especially, I mean, some of the industries that you were talking about with healthcare and everything else.
Yeah.
Bringing it back to salsa.
Chips
and salsa. Well, it's actually coming back. No, this is coming back to salsa.
Okay.
Because I'm seeing it, there's a, you brought a cheat sheet for once on
no,
the
I
show.
Didn't. No, I did.
And I can, I see the prompt there. How secure / spicy are your container images.
Yep.
Now, I know you announced chips. I'm not trying to distract from that. Yep. But spicy, salsa, I couldn't help but ask.
Yeah, and you know, we've got basically a couple of different dimensions that we can grade that container on. We talked about minimalism. That's a starting point. Remove things that don't need to be there. By the way, in the dev images, you might need that package manager. You might need that shell. But when you run it in production,
Right. Let's
remove that. So get rid of that. The second dimension is provenance. Provenance is knowing where those binaries came from. Reproducibility is the highest level, so being able to have fully reproducible packages, images, builds ensures that you can get back to that point from the source code. In too many cases, and this is one of the problems that the Chainguard Libraries product that we announced last week at Assemble solves, too many times companies are dependent on binaries that they can't actually guarantee the reproducibility of. They're fetching it from the internet, and these are jar files, these are Python wheels, these are NPM packages that come from a third party or the internet, curl or Git or somewhere, FTP, and it's like plugging that straight into production. We're trying to guard against that by reproducing all of those artifacts, bootstrapping them, reproducing them straight from source. So the provenance is the second of the four dimensions that we talk about with the chips levels.
And that helps with the software supply chain issues and supply chain attacks.
Yep.
Are you seeing that organizations are really, I guess, waking up to that? Because to me,
it was
one of these things that, like, S-bombs are great, but it doesn't solve this.
No.
At all.
No, I mean, S-bombs are it's the list of ingredients, it's the food facts on the
right
side of the cereal box. That's, you know, that's not gonna solve your health problems, but at least it exposes what's in that.
Makes you aware.
Food. Yeah, it makes you aware. So it's a good starting point, but there's, you know, a second level of ensuring the quality of those ingredients, right? So S-bombs do their part. They also inform the scanners and, you know, all of the other places that are helping assess your security posture. Where Chainguard comes in, of course, is we try to help ensure those scanner results are as good as possible. The third level of our CHIPS framework applies here for sure, which is around the configuration and metadata. Ensuring that there aren't secrets or passwords or API keys baked into the image, that's, you know, the first level. Getting that out of the image and into metadata, attached volumes or something like that. I mean, just 3 weeks ago, the TJ Actions exploit, I don't know if you track this, but I mean, this was just a face-melting exploit taken advantage of GitHub Actions used by thousands of organizations. Turns out it was a targeted attack. The researchers believe it was, you know, targeting a particular financial services institution. But the fallout of this, the blast radius was incredible, and there were thousands of organizations affected by this. And so ensuring that those secrets aren't in the images themselves, getting that out, and the configuration being something that gets, you know, attached later is the third dimension.
Yeah.
Metadata has definitely been one of the things we've been talking about more and more lately. I mean, it's a meta conversation to talk about metadata, but I think it's all the more important, especially as we scale up into AI land.
Yep.
and to protect that. Okay, so you've told us about three of the dimensions. What's the fourth dimension?
Fourth one is really our starting point, but vulnerabilities, right? Ensuring that there are no vulnerabilities. And you can start with vulnerabilities have their own ratings from critical, high, to medium, to low. The simplest level of chips would be no critical vulnerabilities, at least patch those. Second level is no critical or high or medium or, you know, low, no vulnerabilities whatsoever is what we strive for. And at Chainguard, our customers that pay Chainguard for access to our images, we keep those at zero CVEs per our SLA. So we're really shooting for the ability to run any of ChainGuard's images in the most, you know, chip's highest level, spiciest level, which means no vulnerabilities, which means reproducible, you know, built from source. It means no secrets baked in. Secrets are baked into the image itself that comes in strictly through metadata, and then as minimal as possible, removing the shell and the package manager and everything like that when you deploy it into production.
It makes a lot of sense. And it makes a lot of sense why it's the ghost pepper level quality there that you've got going on. I'm curious, you and I have been to multiple KubeCons. I think this is probably our fourth sitting on the desk together, maybe even more than that.
Maybe so, yeah.
And so have you noticed any new projects, or are there any new conversations you've had this week that maybe we haven't had at other ones?
Yeah, I think one thing that I'm very happy to see, there were certainly predictions that we'd seen peak KubeCon, peak CNCF. There were predictions that there would be consolidation of startups and smaller companies. I think there's still just tremendous diversity in the types of, well, people of course, but the types of companies and startups and everything around. It's not totally dominated by the couple of hyperscalers, right, that, you know, could have run away with this entire ecosystem. No, there's a lot still interesting going on.
I think you bring up a really good point, and I think, yeah, there's been a few challenges kind of to this community, but I know what you mean when we kind of had these hallway conversations about, are we still growing, what's going on? This is a record KubeCon. There are 14,000 people here.
Bigger than Paris, yeah.
And by a few thousand people. I mean, wow. It's pretty significant growth. Rob, you had mentioned a few times on the show today, it's still about half of the attendees for their first time. So even if, you know, there's newer companies, the expo floor space is literally twice the size of what I thought it was going to be. And I just learned there was the other side of this hallway today. So I think there's a lot more opportunity. I think when it comes to Kubernetes, we're still seeing that uptick start to happen, but not even close to 50% adoption yet. So
I've seen most of today I've spent talking to customers and prospects. My last one, just before coming to the desk here, was a major bank. They brought 24 people to KubeCon.
Wow.
24 people, not exhibiting a booth, brought that many developers, engineers, security architects to this conference to really, you know, learn more about the CNCF ecosystem, the cloud native ecosystem.
I love that as a data point because, you know, and I say this with love as a nerd, this is a bit of a nerd love fest.
Of course.
We all care. The open source community is so open, so helpful, but we're pretty deep in the technical weeds when it comes to certain things. And so to think of a bank investing and sending 24 people, it's not a cheap ticket either to get here.
Right.
Not just even in the flight, but the conference ticket. But I think that says a lot about the interest in our space,
sure,
across vertical and across application, quite frankly. I bet that's also music to your ears over at the ChainGuard team.
Yeah, the containers will always be the starting point for ChainGuard. We've branched out into VMs. I'll be at Google next week, so maybe I'll see you all over again. But there's virtual machines, there's these libraries, there's a bunch of different places that we're taking ChainGuard, but you know, it all really started here with hardened containers that run in a whole lot of Kubernetes, you know.
Yeah. No, it is. It is fun. It's really been fun to see the journey. You've been rocking it at ChainGuard for a while now. What's the future crystal ball for y'all? You seem to be dropping new things every week, so I feel like you're going to have three more announcements for us at Google Cloud Next.
We do have, we've got a fantastic marketing team that stages these out with deliberate intention. We've got an incredible product team. You met Kim last week on the show. The product team keeps us busy with, you know, excellent priorities. Feedback from customers. We actually ran, the day after Assemble in San Francisco, we ran a customer advisory board. So we had about a dozen customers that sat down in one of our investors' boardrooms. They gave us the boardroom for the day.
Nice.
And we walked them through the roadmap. We showed them a whole bunch of things that we are experimenting with, we're thinking about, might be just an idea on a whiteboard. And they gave us their feedback on our roadmap and our products. The other thing we did at the customer event, I'd never seen this before, but it was brilliant. We had a booth at our conference that was product feedback, and we had two product managers sitting there all day long just taking input from customers who could walk by and say, yeah, I like it, but I want this, or I'd like that. And that, you know, openness is a core value. A Chainguard core value is customer obsession, and part of that means taking feedback.
I think that's great, and I mean, it's no surprise that you're achieving the success that you are. All right, you know what I'm going to ask you?
Oh, no.
You know what I'm going to ask you to wrap this up? You've been here before too many times with me. Not too many times. Never enough times with Dustin. What do you hope to be able to say when we're in Amsterdam next year that you can't yet say today?
Yes, indeed. I would love to see that the containers part of our business continues to grow. But we're a multi-product company with, you know, roughly even revenues across multiple products. That's the sign of a really healthy, growing company. I hope that's where we're at. We'll always love containers. We'll always see that community growing. But there are VMs that run underneath those containers, and there are lots of third-party libraries that get plugged into open source and proprietary applications. And I want to know that we're securing those across the board for our customers.
Well, I suspect you will be, knowing you and the team, and especially getting to meet so many of them last week. That was so great. Shout out to your whole team, the whole Chainguard team. You all are rad. You made us feel very welcome, and I'm so glad that we could have you over here in London.
So much,
Dustin,
Savvy.
It is truly a pleasure every time. You're a little bit of a carrot at the end of a long day when I know that I get to talk to you. And I suspect I speak for Rob.
Absolutely.
On that.
I mean, I'm thrilled.
You're a little bit of a beer at the end of a long day, if we're really being honest.
There we go.
Woo, all right.
Carrots and beer for everybody.
I don't know about that combo.
Carrot cake beer. I don't know.
We'll have to revisit
that. Sour.
Well, yeah. I'm not picky at this point in the day, to be completely honest.
Neither am I. So.
Oh, but thank you again, as always. And Rob, thank you. We are 23 segments in to our 30 segments here on our 3 days of coverage on theCUBE at KubeCon and CloudNativeCon in London, England. Woo!
Here we go.
My name's Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.